Lietuvos nacionalinio operos ir baleto teatro tinklalaidė Tekstūra. Sveiki, mėlyjei klausytojai. Su jumis sveikinasi Laura Karnavičiūtė tiesiai iš Lietuvos nacionalinio operos ir baleto teatro. Šiandien man teko garbė ir džiaugsmas pristatyti jums visiškai naują šio teatro projektą – tinklalaidę Tekstūra. Ši tinklalaidė suteiks progą visiems teatro gerbėjams, neišeinant iš namų, pajusti įvairias teatro tekstūras – nuo šilkinio baleto iki aksominės operos ar galbūt net ir varinio orkestro. Tikiuosi, kad dovanosime jums turiningų akimirkų klausantis įdomiausių kūrėjų ir atlikėjų įžvalgų. Ir pirmasis naujosios tinklalaidės herojus – jaunas ir nepaprastai perspektyvus italų režisierius Fabio Čereza, kurio pavardė vis dažniau puikuojasi geriausių šiandienos muzikinio teatro kūrėjų sąrašuose. 2016 metais jis laimėjo tarptautinį operos apdovanojimą kaip geriausias jaunas režisierius. Ir šiuo metu mūsų teatre Fabio ruošia Lietuvos operos šimtmečiui skirtą Giuseppe Verdi šedevro Traviata pastatymą, kurio premjera bent jau kol kas numatyta dar šių metų gruodžio mėnesį. Labai džiugu, kad režisierius rado laiko savo įtemptoje darbotvarkėje ir mes galime pasikalbėti apie įvairias teatrines paslaptis. Norėčiau įspėti, kad mūsų pokalbis vyks anglų kalba ir jūsų patogumui YouTube platformoje taip pat pateiksime titrus lietuvių kalba. I would now like to switch to the language of our conversation to English, and first of all, I should repeat my little introduction and happily announce that the Lithuanian National Opera and Ballet Theatre is seeking new forms of communication, and the result of that is this entirely new project, a podcast that we titled Textures. Each week we will be speaking with the most interesting theatrical personalities and delve deeper into the many beautiful textures of opera and ballet. I'm truly very happy to introduce our very first guest, the young and very talented director from Italy, Fabio Čereza, who is currently creating his version of Giuseppe Verdi's masterpiece La Traviata here in Vilnius, a production that will mark the centenary of opera in Lithuania. So it is a very special work indeed. And at the moment we are planning to show this beautiful new Traviata this year in December. So, dear Fabio, first of all, thank you so, so much for finding this slice of time in your, what I know is an incredibly busy schedule. It's the pre-premiere psychosis, as we like to call it. And I'm very glad that on this very first podcast, we will be speaking about La Traviata, which is such an absolutely iconic work in the Lithuanian history of professional art, as you probably already been told. But to begin, I would like to start from a bit further away and to ask you a very, very simple and very romantic question. What or who made you fall in love with opera?
Oh my God. This is a very interesting question. And I try to recollect my memory now. I remember... This is actually a funny story. I was in Dubai at the time. It was right. 1995 or 1996, and my parents were living there. They traveled the world all their lives. And I was already really interested in classical music, mostly symphonic. And I remember I was watching TV, and there was this program, the name was L'amore è un dardo, which means love is an arrow. And it's a common mistake about a phrase in Il Trovatore of Giuseppe Verdi, because the baritone says L'amore un dardo, the love that makes me burn. But it sounds very similar to this other phrase, the love is an arrow. And they made this program speaking about opera, and the first episode was about Trovatore, and I fell in love with the big duet between Leonora and Conte di Luna in the last act. Mm-hmm. I really think it was love at first sight, so yes, love is an arrow, and at least it was for me.
Yeah, yeah. So that's how you fell in love. That's actually a very interesting story, because usually people say, I saw this production, or I heard this recording or something. So for you, it came actually from a very different place, didn't it?
It was from television, and I must say that it happens really often to meet people who had the first contact with opera through an uncommon way of communication, such as television or the radio or even a podcast like what we are doing right now.
Yeah.
So I think that any way opera finds to touch the heart of the people is absolutely worthy.
Absolutely. So opera doesn't have to be only, in an opera theater or whatever.
That's very true. But I think that once you have this first link, this first contact, the theater is the place where you have to really understand what opera is all about.
Mm-hmm.
So don't be satisfied in listening to opera with your iPod, your phone, or your computer. You have to come to the theater, because the live experience is what really makes the difference.
Yeah, yeah. I absolutely agree with you, actually, on this one. It's worth coming to the theater to see this magic that is opera.
Mm.
And I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think that your connection and your experience with opera is quite extensive, because from what I know, you not only direct opera performances, but you also write your own libretti.
That's
which is very interesting, right? So how do you feel one correlates with the other, and maybe one helps the other? Or
well, not really. I try my best to keep them very apart. And when they ask me to make the direction of the libretto I write, I always try to cool it down, the enthusiasm. I don't think it's working. I think the writer, the librettist, and the director has two very different kind of approach to their job. And they fill the empty space one of each other.
Mm-hmm.
And so doing the direction of my own libretto would just be like repeating myself without adding any real added value to the work.
Right.
But I actually started writing libretto way earlier than I started directing.
Mm-hmm.
I was still in high school. I was 16, 17 years old. And actually, I don't think about myself as a poet. I think about myself as a good artisan. I like to work with the words. I like to work with the text, with the verses, in order to make it work in a mathematically way, with the correct disposition of the accent and of the syllables. So it's something that has not so much to spare with art. It's something very specific and that requires skill. Skills that I like to improve and to use.
Mm-hmm. But that also, I would imagine, it gives you a very broad context. You then become a real person of the opera. You know, you can sense it from all directions. You know, you're on the stage, you're behind the stage writing the libretto. It becomes very, very interesting. You know, you are the real 100% person of the opera. You're the real creator.
You know, there is this opera, the Nerone of Arrigo Boito. It's a not very well-known opera. You know Boito for Mephistopheles,
but
Nerone
is
not very well-known. It's very difficult, not so used to be represented in the theater.
Mm-hmm.
And there is this phrase of Nerone, and the end of the first act, all the chorus arrives to cheer him up and to glorify him. And to make honor of him, they sing some of his verses. And his reaction is, cantano i versi miei, they are singing my verses. And they really do share this emotion with him. The idea that you do something and this something is made alive by people who take the, you know, dead material and they take it to life is really something incredible. Mm. I must say that in this direction, I felt the same when just a couple of days ago, I walked on stage and I saw they're building up the set of Traviata. And they're building up something that, you know, happened in my mind a few time ago. Mm-hmm. And the idea that something that is creating from nothing in a very confused part of my mind is then converted in something that you can touch mm-hmm. is really incredible in this
it's
experience.
Fantastic, isn't yes. it? Yeah. So... since you yourself touched upon this side of yourself that is an opera director, I would be very interested to know when you begin, let's say, working on a new production, where would you say does your creative inspiration begin? Is it with the sounds of the score or with the words of the libretto?
It or absolutely with the story? Always... it starts from the music, never from the text. The text is driving you in a way that not always is the correct one.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I like to give you an example. Madame Butterfly, the duet at the end of the first act, mm-hmm. Cho Cho San is singing with Pinkerton, and she says that she's happy to see him. He's tall and beautiful, and he laughs in so an outstanding way. And she ends this concept saying, I'm happy now. If you follow the text, you should think that she's actually really glad in this moment. But the music is going in a completely different way.
Exactly.
Or son contenta, ta 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 tam, pam pam pam, or son contenta.
Yes, it even ends with a minor.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that means that the facade of her being happy is clearly spoiled by the sorrow she feels. By the damnation of the uncle and the renegation of the family. So this music is what you always have to listen to understand what you need to translate in action.
Yeah. Well, music really, I do agree that music is everything in opera, isn't it? I mean, the dramaturgical line is very important, but mm-hmm. but this is a fantastic example you've given. I think I felt it when I listened to Madame Butterfly, but you put it exactly the way it really is. Yeah, that little phrase, yeah. it's a great.
And also, you know, sometimes during the concertato on the sestetto, six people plus the chorus are singing six different things, and you're not able to follow the line of everyone.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
What you have to do is to understand the general mood that you need for the scene mm-hmm. and try to build up something that is understandable and enjoyable for the audience.
Absolutely. So now in Vilnius, in this theater, you are not staging Madame Butterfly yet. Maybe sometime in the future. But you are working on the opera of all operas, that is La Traviata. And do you happen to remember your very first experience of La Traviata? When and how did you get acquainted with this particular opera? Because I feel that every person who has something to do with the opera world, they have their own personal experience of how they first heard or saw this beautiful masterpiece that Giuseppe Verdi wrote.
So, you know, in Italy we have this way of saying you don't study Traviata, you know Traviata. It's mm-hmm. part of our DNA, and the music of Verdi is streaming in our blood. So I really don't remember when was the first time that I listened to it.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, there are pages like, let's take the famous toast, Libiamo, Libiamo, negli eti calici, is one of the maybe five pages of classical music of opera that everybody knows, and they don't even know what the words are about or what the title from which it's taken is speaking about. Mm-hmm. You just know it because it catches your imagination, and it has the chance to drive you completely to this kind of world and make a whole imaginarium start to float above your head. I think for me, the moment I think I really felt in love with this opera was when I first listened to the Addio del Passato. It's a page in the last act in which Violetta says goodbye forever to the beauty and the youth and the joy that she used to experience. And I was a little boy at the time, and it was quite unusual for me to think about saying goodbye forever to something that I was experiencing at the moment because I was young. And I think the music of Verdi really made a miracle in making it possible for me to empathize with someone, with a character that was so far and so different from who I was. At the time, you know, I studied in a military college when I was young.
Wow!
I have a past.
My of, God!
Many different experiences.
Yeah.
And I remember I was sitting at my desk with my CD playing. It was back in the 90s, so you didn't have any MP4 at the time.
Yeah.
And I was listening to this aria and to the finale of Traviata, and I remember I cried at the end. And one of my friends entered in my room and saw me in this condition, and I was very worried. He thought that something was going on, and so he came to me asking, oh my God, what is going on, what happens? I say, no, you know, Violetta died. And he told to me, oh my God, he thought it was something serious. And I answered to him that it actually was, you know, the death of Violetta is something that so many people experienced, that so many people empathized with, way more than with the death of a real person. So this fictional character who is Violetta is actually closer to our hearts than many of the people that are actually living with us in the real world.
Right. And this is an interesting subject, by the way, because I think that in general, the story of La Traviata, it can be viewed from very different angles, and it is often viewed from different angles, you know, because for some people, you know, it is a beautiful fairy tale. For others, it is, well, they say, oh, it's a, you know, sentimental love story, or whatever they choose to call it. But I think everyone will agree that La Traviata is exceptionally moving. You cannot be not touched emotionally by what happens in this opera. And how would you say, what creates this magical effect? It's probably not just the story, is it? I think we should begin with the music and how it develops these characters and everything that happens.
Absolutely, it's a mix of the story of Violetta and how Verdi did portray this character so deep in so many levels. You know, there is a beautiful anecdote that I want to tell you about this guy that like 100 years ago went to La Scala with his fiance. They were supposed to get married in a few months, and they went to see La Traviata. And the next day he wrote her a letter breaking the engagement and telling her, I cannot imagine how could I spend my life with someone who attended the story of Violetta and didn't get moved.
Wow.
So she didn't cry, and it was a deal breaker for him. How can we not understand him completely? No?
Absolutely, 100%.
It's impossible. Even, you know, I know Traviata by heart, I could sing it to you from the last note to the first, as many others does. And still, every time I listen to it, it finds the way to my heart. It finds the way to touch my inner cords and make me really find this pure core that is in the bottom of my soul and, you know, making me empathize so strongly with her. I think the secret is the fact that we are looking at this opera and we are exactly the same people who would condemn her in the everyday life. You know that I think the novel of Dumas of the late 40s of the 1800, and Traviata is, correct me, 1853 should be, so it was really a fashionable novel at the moment, and Verdi was really up to find the most interesting hit in order to convert them in opera. And it was quite unusual because being a tragedy, you are not supposed to set it in the time of the audience, in the time in which you're writing it.
Correct, yes.
So usually the tragedy are always in a, you know, mythological past, no, in out of the time, no, so you can have the distance that you need in order to better understand how everything is working. The contemporary setting is something more for the opera buffa. Let's think about Notte di Figaro, for example, no. So Verdi wanted it to be set in the same age as he was writing the music. And as we know, he was forced to set it like 60 or even more years before, given a totally different design for the very first performance, set, I think, in the 18th century, if not even the 17th. So now we are back staging it in the middle 19th century, in the 1850, more or less. And I used to ask to myself, is it more true to the intention of Verdi, setting it in the time he wrote it, or in the contemporary age of the audience who is seeing the title?
Right.
So I'm a very traditional Italian kind of director, so I would never announce to have enormous skirt and the biggest crinoline we can have. And I think that setting it back in the 19th century doesn't take off anything about the strength and the worth of the music. Also, the society changed somehow, so the role of the father is a little different, and even you know, the position that a person like Violetta and the job that he does has in our contemporary society, I think, is way less terrible than it was. But still, it's the story of someone who tries to fit in a society, and the society is refusing her. We are this society. We are judging her, and this is why we have this double kind of way to witness to her tragedy, because we empathize with her, we have this immedesimation with her, but still we know that we are the, as she said, the implacable man who is condemning her.
Yeah. And I think it's also very interesting that, of course, not many people talk about this, but in La Traviata, there is so much death going on in the opera. I mean, what I'm trying to say is that, of course, people die all the time in operas, right? You can't have a proper opera without at least one death, and preferably the death of a soprano, right? It has to happen. But what I mean to say is that in the case of La Traviata, we have this death hanging upon the stage like a sort of a doom right from the first act. Right, because we know that she, we already know in the first act that she's very unwell and she's probably not going to make it. So isn't that also a very strong aspect of this opera, this very serious subject of death and of how someone so young has to give up life, and that makes everything so much more moving and so much stronger. The love becomes stronger, the emotion becomes stronger because you know that, you know, this person has so little time left on this earth.
It's absolutely true. The death of Violetta is something that you know is going to happen since the very beginning of the show. It's not some accident like happened in Tosca or something that could be avoided, as in Rigoletto, for example. Mm-hmm. The experience that other characters do during the opera are not influenced by the death. That is something that happened at the end as, you know, the weird and unplacable working of the events. But in the case of Violetta, the death is something that waits for her since the very first note. And in this production, we will underline this in a very strong way, making her illness visible on her skin since the preludio that opens the first act. What makes this topic of the death so interesting in this opera is that is not making us facing this concept, thinking about when we will die, but how we can live before we do.
Right.
So, you know, and this running to the end of Violetta is not trying to push the death far from her and trying to postpone the moment she will die, but is on the opposite, and we should take a great example on it, trying to make every day worth and try to live the day that we have in the best way we can.
Right. That really is the most important message, isn't it? Yeah. And if I remember correctly, you have already produced several Traviatas in the past. I think this is your number four, probably.
This is my number four.
Number four.
It's so true.
Yeah. So what would you say is different this time now that you work here in Vilnius? Because I imagine it would be interesting for you as a creator to make these productions a little bit different every time, because you're growing as a person and as an artist. So there must be new discoveries each time you do it.
That's absolutely true. If I will do another Traviata in 2 years, it will be different. Not necessarily better, but different, of course. Yeah. And I like to think that the first Traviata I did had some naivete that I miss him now that I'm so used to the dust of the stage. No? So every time you face a title, you are just presenting to the audience the inner world that you are embodying at the moment. And yes, you know, 4 Traviata and 4 different concepts for a different work of art. But I must say that I'm trying to do my best to make this Traviata the best I did so far.
Of course. Well, we're hoping for that, of course.
I hope the same.
And from what I've seen already, little glimpses on the stage, I'm my heart is completely sold on this Traviata. And
mine
I think
too.
It's good.
I can't wait to start to leave the rehearsal room and start rehearsing on stage. I can't wait to see the set. I can't wait to see the character in costume. I'm very lucky. I have a great team of designer working with me. Mm-hmm. And I really do hope we will give to the audience something impressive to watch.
Yeah, so just to end with, could you give our audience a little bit of a teaser of what they're going to see when they come to the theater to see this Traviata? How is this going to be the best Traviata of their lives?
I don't know of their lives, of course, of mine. You know, I used to think that when you go to the theater, you have some expectation. And as a director, I always ask to myself, I'm sitting in my chair and the curtains open, what I would like to see? Mm-hmm. And trying to answer to this question, I speak with my colleagues in order to develop a project which is, first of all, visually appealing. I'm quite well known for not being a minimalist. I like to call myself a maximalist. So mm-hmm. I like to be over the top and I like to use kilometers of fabric and very strong color palette and jewels and everything who can make the theater experience of the opera something that you not forget and something that really create this kind of dream and imaginarium that we associate with opera. And this is the only way I think we can really take the opera to the next century. So we will see, first of all, an incredible set which will recall the idea of a huge and majestic palace in the Paris of 150 years ago. High walls, big doors, amazing boiserie, and rich tapestry in a shade of colors that goes from the peacock green to the strong pink, magenta, and even electric blue and purple. The costume will go in color blocking with them. So in the first act, the scene, which is green, has all the costume in pink shades in order to have this, you know, incredibly visually appealing contrast. Mm-hmm. And we are also using a lot of the color purple. The color purple is the color of the death, as we know in our tradition, yes. And is also the color of lavender. Lavender is the typical flower that grows up in the south of France, in Provence, the country where Alfredo comes from. Mm-hmm. And since Violetta, in the first act, receive you know, in the same day the gift of the love together with the gift of the death, everything is merging together. This is why we will use this color purple and the idea of the lavender flower in a very memorable way. In the finale of the last act, the walls will open, revealing a huge lavender field which lost itself in the horizon and the infinity. And this is the paradise that waits for Violetta and where she will end her experience in a peaceful and dreamy way.
Mm-hmm. Well, I certainly can't wait to see it. I think that everyone who are listening to this podcast, they're getting very excited as well. So thank you so much, Fabio, for spending this time with us. It's wonderful to hear your ideas. You're obviously very passionate about opera, and it's always happiness to be in the presence of a person like you. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Laura, for having me. I was honored to be the first guest of your podcast.
Yes, and I truly hope that, you know, this very difficult situation that we're in, it's going to ease up. I very consciously don't ask you, oh, how it is, you know, working in these times, because we speak about this so much. I think it's time to really concentrate on the positive and to work and to create and to be happy with what we can do at the moment. And I hope that this La Traviata will see the light of day very soon, and this will be, I know that this will be a very beautiful gift to our theater and to our audiences. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you very much, Fabio, for having me. Bye.
Iš tiesų labai dėkoju nuostabiajam Fabio už jo skirtą laiką ir belieka tikėtis, jo klastingo viruso gniauštai šiek tiek atlaisvės ir vis dėlto leis mums visiems pasimėgauti premierinės Traviatos grožiu. O kol kas, kol teatro durys užvertos, kviečiu prisijungti prie mūsų socialiniuose tinkluose Facebook, YouTube ir Instagram, kuriuose gyvenimas verda, nepaisant visų suvaržymų. Ir jau visai netrukus pristatysime jums ir antrąją tinklalaidės tekstūrą – seriją. Labai dėkoju, kad buvote drauge su mumis, likite sveiki ir iki kitų susitikimų. Lietuvos nacionalinio operos ir baleto teatro tinklalaidė – tekstūra –